So ask monitoring increase to shoot commander. I tell you what, open your eyes. Don't shot. Don't take a rocket. You better watch one more beat up in mind.
Then you see, this is,
he said, wow, I saw your 127, and this is 0.127. No guts to enter, now regret.
This is
not Jeff, this is another friend of mine.
What?
Jeff already entered at 0.121. And you see, after that he said, I took half of it. That means he took about 0.13 something, 0.14 something, okay? After that, they saw GMG 155 distributed now. Yeah. Now it's a 151. Very good movie. Super idol.
So how I know?
Very simple. When the stock is about to move, you better listen to it. When the stock is about to move, especially penny stocks, when it's about to move, the big volume at certain price become very, very low. And high volume, but the ask volume something to actually matter. Why is it so?
Because
the big boys want to do something. They want you to cut loss, they want you to do it. Do it again? Fine, it's on.
It's on.
But I'm telling you upfront, it's not easy to do it. Because every stock, they have different behavior in the big sell, the big ask. The CapitaLand, you will not see 2 million, you will see 200 over 1,000. And when I watch CapitaLand, some days the bid becomes 500, and then the ask becomes 200. So naturally, it's what? Buyers more, right? So after that, when I saw that, the thing went up. Then after that, I see the next price went 500 and then 300, then the thing went up again. So what I'm trying to do is that this method is like I cannot prove the evidence for you, but I'm a witness.
Yeah.
One will be for witness. My wife will know about you. You know, I'm a witness. GMG trade, CapitaLand trade, Oceanus trade. This guy, at the right time, he called me. And he witnessed that he didn't saw the thing, but over the conversation, he witnessed, because we are watching the same screen, agree? I was watching my watch list, and he's watching his watch list, and the watch list sure contained GMG or CapitaLand one. So when it happened live, I tell you what, he saw everything. And I will let him speak so that he can tell him more of it. Okay? Want to listen?
Yes.
Okay, before I move on. Now, what's Nobis egg? Well, nobody wants Nobis egg. When you know him, it's not easy to invite him. Because he's a 3-time millionaire. To invite him, I need to wait a lot of breath. You know? Because I'm not a millionaire. And I need to spend a lot of time called asking if you can come, you know. This might be my last seminar, you know, because I don't know what else can I talk about. The last one I talk about is trading without charts anymore, which is the buy sell queue. So what my next seminar is, I don't know. I have to think of something creative, or I have to think of something that I can talk about. This really could be my last seminar. So if you want me to hold seminar, it will be good for you, okay? So if you say no, then okay. Okay, but this guy, because this is my last seminar, so I need to invite him to speak, because he is someone that makes a million 3 times. Who make a million 1 time in his life? Here, anyone here make a million once in his life? No one. No, but this guy made 3 times, so God is very kind to him, you know. One time he made, go broke. Second time made, go broke. Third time he made, he bought property. So he reserved his fund in his property. Okay? So I will let him speak, and he will tell you more about the all the things that I didn't teach him anything. He's not my student. But I just doing that the right moment when that thing happened, he witnessed, or I should say, he saw it with his own eyes. Okay? So let's invite him to speak.
speak well.
It's okay.
We have three times.
Yeah.
Last night I was on the phone with Ronald until 3 a.m. and very groggy.
Yeah, because I was very upset. I'm calling. I know market going ready, but I'm not inside it. So I can't sleep last night.
I want to do a revenge and trick on Captain Hank. To get back.
Okay, Ronald and I I know him through Robin's course. We were ex students of Robin. And Ronald, after I made $1 million, I spent most of my money on the property. So I have about 200k. So I spent 100k on any course. Okay, and attend Robin's course, attended a lot of digital time, online training academy, option ethics, a lot of courses. And after attending a lot of these courses, I try to incorporate their techniques into my trading scheme. Each night, I try to incorporate their techniques into my system. I always lose my... It's like organ transplant in your body and you get rejection. Okay, but after sampling a lot of these courses, I find they're all pursuing some common strategy. First is that I think most of them use techniques that are very well known in the market, and they all use very set patterns. Okay, timelines like indicators and holding everything. And the first thing before I handle those courses is that the first thing is that you go for a free preview, right? 1 hour free preview. And in this preview, they will try to brainwash you, right? They try to tell you that yes, it's the best, yeah, hot shot instructor has been interviewed many times on trade times like in CNBC and all that. And then they play a video of his prediction. And then later I'll check out the internet and see how many predictions this guy is going to have. Usually I find that most of the predictions are wrong. And the only time they will write, they'll be flashing it in the screen to you. It's called selective sampling, huh? And it's the most common tactic in marketing, right? And in fact, it's only natural everybody try to put on their best front. Even aspect of impressive wine for the first time. So it's very natural. But the only thing is that when I start reading, and even some of these courses, when people ask them, can you tell me any stock? So everybody will, if the guy will go through his meta stock, always flash, he always flash through the most trendy part of the stock to illustrate that his technique works. There's one school, they use only averages to teach the swing trading, and every time he say, I'm going to show you how successful my method is. I think he keeps scrolling to the part of the chart where it's very trendy. And for sure, you know, when the market is trendy, any method will work. Even your grandmother also know it. And a lot of them all use a date chart. Means they use a date, a PowerPoint chart, or a date with a stock chart on the weekend. When the chart is dead, you know what happened, right? Even your grandmother also going to tell you, if the general trend of the candlestick is this way, always can draw any line here, you will cut. I say, you see, just cut my line and buy here and then sell it. And the chart comes out from here, straight away you say, I draw a line that's opposite angle to that. You say, oh, you see, cut my line, sell there, buy back here. So obvious. Because the chart is dead. Mentally, when you see a chart, straight away you can draw a line that will cut the chart in the
most convenient way such that you can sell that idea. Okay? So always it's only when you come to a live chart where the right side is empty, that's where you really test your skill, whether your method works or not. Okay. So those people who present in those schools where they try to do it on the at night when markets come on. Okay, but then after the attending morning call, then one day Ronald started his blog and he did a call. I said, I started a blog, I come and watch it. So at first I watched. So at first I was skeptical like most people. I'm saying, okay, Ronald is a Robin student, how can he do better? pleasantly, as I watched post by post, I was pleasantly surprised that actually Ronald's calls are pretty accurate. I'm sure you all follow his post by post. And this is where you really get something of the guy's performance. Unlike those 1 hour quick review where the guy will give you what he wants to give you after the event. So as I follow Ron's talk, he makes all those predictions like PMI every morning, 8:30 he writes, I think the market will get down and slowly turn up. And after a while, after successive sampling, I think you get a feel that there is a method to his madness. Although he talked about the EVs and all of that, but I don't believe that. I thought, hey, Ron is talking like somebody from Red somewhere. Then I check internet, EVs, markup, markdown, it landed me on a website called DSA, Orange Spread Analysis. Wow. But then I started to download the DSA book, ebook, and read it. Actually, find it didn't really work for me. Then I keep asking for are you using DSA? He said no, no, I said I don't believe it. But then later on, I read more posts and more posts, and then I find it actually doesn't work with DSA. I think it's more powerful than that. Most of the, all those products I attended, they use set techniques. Basically, ask you to look at the card trend line. And the problem trend line is that one time I went to a trend line instructor, you draw lines, and then the candlestick is not bounce off his line and does not react to his line. So he adjusts his line. And in one line he adjusts 4 or 5 times. As the stock movement, as the candlestick movement. Then I asked his assistant, hey, how come he draw 4 or 5 lines and he doesn't react? He keeps adjusting. And then finally, when the market stopped, then he found the correct line, so he draw a straight line. He hit his candlestick, hit his line and bounce on. And then hit the other line. So I said, why are you iterating the other line that doesn't work? Oh, it's housekeeping. So it reminds me, housekeeping okay, right? It's like you're drawing a caricature sketch. Afterwards, you rub away all the original draft lines. Or it's like when you program a computer program. After a while, you find that all those extraneous program lines, you just erase them. And then you introduce new variables to make the program short and modular. So I thought housekeeping is a very innocent thing to do. When I was actually training with those trend lines, I realized each time I do a housekeep, it's funny. Because I draw the 4 or 5 of my what I think is the best trend line and it doesn't react. And each time it doesn't react, I lose nothing. So when I say 4 out of 5 times the trend line doesn't work, that means 4 or 5 times you lose money. And of course, at the end of the day, draw the line that reacts to most of the points, of the pivot point, and then I erase all those lines that doesn't work. And I find that this attitude is actually a very dishonest attitude to yourself. That means you're not acknowledging the failure of your method. When you erase all those lines that doesn't work and only keep the line that works. It shows that 4 out of 5 times your method doesn't work. And it's like Fibonacci.
You keep drawing.
4 or 5 lines, then you hit 1 of the 9. What about the other 4 lines? Doesn't hit. Does it mean that it doesn't. Something very similar, it's like moving average. If you draw a moving average, you moving average to 100. Then you find that your own line doesn't react to your moving average to 100. So you adjust to 250. So it's the same thing. If you keep adjusting the thing, it's probably not working. That's why you keep adjusting. And one thing I noticed when I'm wrong is that when a method doesn't work, you face it squarely and honestly, try to ask why and reflect on it. So you come up with something like, why? So you need a very honest attitude towards your record keeping, your training journal. Whether your method really works. So Ronald, when he wrote his blog and his approaching problem, higher order thinking aspect, means try to think what the big boys think about the repair. So it's a higher order game. It's like our primary school children learn higher order thinking. How to think about how the examiner set his problem, check it to the very high order. So it's a big test. I got to think one step ahead. I got to think of how good to react to my home and what is my home friend. And even one higher order, I got to think of how he thinks I'm going to react to his home. And even more. So I thought that actually this could be the real this psychology part of it. How the big boys try to trick the retail. This one could be the real explanation behind all those market behavior that we learn. These are actually manifestation of this game. Trend line, what I'm trying to do. So the underlying explanation of all those set patterns that we learn actually it's very important that I think from a philosophical point of view or from a practical money point of view that I want to master this book. Go to your underlying. And it's very highly functional. Trust me, I like to Google if anybody come with a method, I'll try to prove that this method is not original and try to Google, find all the keywords and prove that it's not original. But I feel actually I look at BSA, I look at the law, I look at the theory of tick fakes, theory of this, theory of that. I want to find out that closely resemble what Ron is using. I think what attracts me and probably most of you is you're very honest about your losses. I think if I were a blogger and if I got a very big blog, I'd be very embarrassed to publish it. And he's honest about his losses. I think I'm sure that if I Ronald, when you ask him a question, he's very spontaneous and very genuine. You can ask him to point to any part of the time, ask him and he'll try his best to explain my things. Unlike those super cool out there, if you try to point him to a part of the time, why he has a feel of the thing, I think he'll try to brush it away. There's a buffet out there, Christian. I'm trying to warn you, I'll rush you aside. So with the blog, I think you know, cannot escape the scrutiny of having that call. Because then people have to. Even told his open trade, so I keep track of his score of whether his open trade is sending rate or sending yield. And when he send rate, I would expect Ronald to just keep quiet about it. But to my surprise, I don't have to publish it. And it's from this process that Ronald, I think, came out with the I don't know exactly know what the K-time is. Don't ask me. I'm not a student. But I, in the process of talking to him, is what I hope to achieve is that I also have my own system, and I try to correlate what he sees with what I see. And in the process, slowly, compare the merits with the merits of this system and hopefully some of the stuff is entered into my system. Okay, that's what I hope to do by talking to him and following the blog. I think this one, those who follow the blog will know that I think it was spot on all those key levels. In three seminars, each time you give one key level and was one of very precise and very precise. At first I thought he got this level from some trend line method. So I tried to reproduce his key level using trend line, the using projection or trend line. But it's not very convincing to me. Because I produced, in addition to this level, I also produced three or four other levels which I don't know how to erase. Okay. So then last night Ronald told me that actually he did a lot of probing just before he arrived at this level. And that brought me to the days of Jesse Livermore. Right? How many of you read Jesse Livermore's book? Jesse Livermore is he's the first trader who, big time trader, who I think close to $100 billion equivalent of operation just during early 2019 for Great Britain. And he had a book, right? Reminiscences of the stock trader. And he described a lot of stuff like the reaction, and the pivot line, the pivot point, probing, after you make the money. Put half into the reserve, give it to your wife essentially. So that you have no chance of getting it back and losing it back off. Things like that. When I read this Livermore book, I read it three times, but I thought it's just a good book and I went on to another next good book to read. But I didn't really practice this thing. So then when I met Roland, he's the first guy I met who really practiced Jesse Livermore's spirit. They do probing. They really spend money to find out where the level is. And that was a pleasant surprise to me. And all those things that Jesse Livermore talked about, the reaction, the pivot point. The pivot point is the K turn. And the KMI and the one I don't think Jesse Livermore talked about. And those reactions. It's only after talking to Ronald and following his book that Jesse Livermore came alive, you know, in the SGX market. Okay. So that's where I realized that I met somebody that is very unique. Pretty genius. The kind of hacking spirit that the bit of Facebook. So on many occasions by key time, I asked you to share this one because I was looking at the Hang Seng Index. Because when I trade stocks, I look at the Hang Seng Index, Hang Seng futures, and the leading indicator. So when the
Sunday, I saw, I think he saw that he knows that people are going to come. And before that, somebody whacked 500 rocks. Then Ronald said it's a fake bowling, but I can't see, I can't see fake bowling. I can't see, but and then Ronald shouted at 2x4 into the after the fake bind. And then after that Captain Lang start to move down without reaction, and then I saw something that so I thought Ronald would be the turn in Captain. What Ronald sees is that little Captain Lang, little stop of Captain Lang, has is correlated has some implication for what I'm looking at in the hunting futures. And say you see the world in a grain of sand. That grain of sand is looking at Captain Lang, you can deduce what's happening in that open universe called hunting. So it's amazing to me that this caveman thing is a very powerful thing that I hope I can learn in my lifetime.
I'm sure you all have seen many times how Ronald applies K-9 to at 8:30 a.m. in the morning outside, how the SDI is going to open and how it's going to move. Key turn, I'm sure, also, right? Most of the turns,
Key turns.
Okay, the conclusion I have, Ronald didn't pay me a single cent to talk, okay? I think is that
the precision is uncanny, precision and prescience. I cannot find a more blocks. Maybe you have found some that prescience and precision. I mean, those three levels given at each seminar, they are unambiguous. It's not talking for both sides of the mouth. You know, it's sometimes you talk to you give you this level, in the end you don't know which level. You say you break this level, then this level, you break this level, then this level. That is talking from three sides of the mouth, right? So when he did that level, he was certain that one will stay there for quite a long time. The 2525 on the first seminar, the 2900 the second seminar, and the 3030 at the third seminar. All those levels is still staying there until today. So I'm very impressed by his precision. Those key levels he provide at the seminar. And also those predictions he made on the blocks. And also my those events that I witnessed on his K time. Those times he shorted and the market went down without reaction. And I like his approach to the market. It's not some set pattern, you know. You know, a set pattern versus the. You know, martial arts, right? You know, Jet Li win a lot of martial arts competition, right? But Jet Li's martial arts cannot be used for real fighting on the street. It's Jet Li, right here, no? I mean, he do all those soft fighting and stiff fighting, and those are good for martial arts competition and win prizes for the best performance, but it cannot be used for real fighting. Okay. And then they are the real stiff fighter. Those are the people who really go beyond the set pattern to see how you to think about how the enemy will react to take move, and then he try to counter that. Take or whatever. Those are the real things. And those are what is the real market. And those are like the true skin. You can really find your skin. Like. So I'm sure, so after reading 1 year of those blogs, this funny question, how did he do it? Can I achieve what he's doing? Okay, incorporate his method. do I just want to carry on reading this book this 1 year every morning and every day to find out how we find the thing for the day, or do I go on to go beyond that? So now I share with you I take more slides. Very fast. Next one. Yeah. Sometimes you know I take volume, take by cube.
This is what I observe about portion.
Right
at
the market peak
of
the
one of
the
peak
of portioners.
After you told me what to observe, I go.
You know,
I saw 7,000
houses
on the buy queue, okay? On the sell queue. Okay, this is the sell queue, this is the buy queue.
Then you must see.
And later on,
I also observed this
for another stock as well.
During
the peaking process.
7,000
on this side. The PR price is 9,600.
You think what's the other side?
Then as the price goes up, my sell queue stay about the same. Then once towards the peak, that's the peak, 9.9 to buy and 10 cents to sell. Suddenly, the, I don't know who, could be wrong. Check out from 7,000 to about 20,000. And then the buy queue, you know. As the price goes up, suddenly the buy queue suddenly shoots up. Normally, if I see this buy queue suddenly shoot up, I'll be conditioned like the dog, Pavlov dog. I will jump in and buy. But true enough, right after the buy queue appear, jump up by 3 times the previous queue. Then suddenly, the price collapsed. After a while. I think about a few minutes. Then the price collapsed. And on the retreat of the price, the buy queue keep maintaining. It means 9.9. Then suddenly the 9.9 buy queue disappear, 15,000 off disappear. Then suddenly came down. The 15,000 off suddenly appear on the 9.8. So when you see you want to buy queue there, a big buy queue there, I think you got this fear to short. Such a big buy queue there. And so this is one of the my game that one of the many in my game. Okay, so another one. Next one. I think this one is about tipping. I got 2 slides on tipping. This time I get a tip, I sure lose money. Okay, this one, no matter how good the tip is and how good the intention is. On Meiwa, one time he, when Meiwa was 29 cents, Ronald detected that it's going to break out. Before the breakout happened. 29, he told me he bought 200 and tell me to buy. But I, being the skeptical guy that I am, I say, could this be a bad tip? And I don't place an index. I cannot hold for very long. So I say, let's wait for some confirmation. So in my mind, confirmation means I wait for it to move. So for one whole day, after staring for 1 hour, 59 cents. Didn't move, so I forget about it. Okay, so then the next day, open up at 61 cents and Ronald, I think he bought more a lot, 62, and he pushed it up. So he moved, but when Ronald bought at 62 cents, more a lot, a lot of other people jump in. Before I know it, it's already 65. So when I notice 64, 65, okay, before that, I asked Ronald, can give me a price target? Normal tip is like that, right? Give me an actual price, expensive price. So Robert said, 71 cents got chance, 71 cents got chance. So I put there 71 cents in my hand. So when it went to 65, so after Ronald launched a 200 lot at 62, a lot of people jump in because if Ronald told me that that morning had opened the mirror was in the top volume time. And then when Ronald saw that, he tried to push it up, so he put 200 lot at 62 cents to buy. And then after that, a lot of people jump in, probably at 64, 65. When stock 64, 65, I said, okay, this is the price confirmation of Ronald's tip. Maybe his tip is good. Okay, he confirmed to me that his tip is good. But then, why did I jump in? Because my mind was fixated on 71 cents. So I said, hey, if I enter at 65, I still got 6 cents to make, right? So I jump in. So when I jump in, before I know it, Ronald start dumping it at 66 cents. It's 400 lot. He dumped on me. good for his wife. So immediately, I think Ronald saw something, right? He saw some, like what he saw in Oceanus or something, maybe some.
The buy sell
queue. The buy queue suddenly become very big. Ronald see sign of danger, so he start dumping. Fake queue. So he down, and then straight away, pop. So before I know it, I wasn't reading the fake queue, because yeah, I don't know how to read. Fake buy, fake sell. So pop. So for me, I got this automatic. The moment I do it to do my buy, I always cut off. I mean, this is my automatic ingrained. So pop, I cut 63. So naturally after cutting at 63, I bought at 65, cut at 63, I lost 4,000, I feel a bit sore. I say, okay, a good tip.
Go back.
So I want to make back, I want to revenge. So on that day, it stopped at 62. And then a strange feeling come to me, I say, hey, Ronald bought at 62, 200 lot, right? So maybe if I buy a C2 now, I bought at Ronald's entry. I must be quite smart. Anyway, now it's good. Anyway, I'm further away from my target. I got more to make, right? That even give me more motivation to buy. So 71 cent target, then I buy 62. Wow, now I can make even more. Make 9 cent. So I went in again. Partly because I want to make back from what I lost here. And partly because the 71 target is there, fixated in my mind. So the more it drops, the more I have to buy. Okay? This is not called averaging down, because averaging down means I didn't cut, I just keep buying. This one is I cut already, then I thought, maybe here I can buy again. Why? Because of this. Okay? 71 cent target, fixated in my mind. After I buy, then it went down 50 cents. But I cut it 2 cents. So in this tip, it was a good tip. But given with the best of intention in the most timely manner, it's just that everybody reacts to tip in a different way. I give a tip now, I don't think you will take it right. You wait for some confirmation of your kind, right? Then you go in. Right? By then it's too late. Right? It's always like that. I can tell you another I call it a fa bing chong chi, fa bing zi. This thing is there. You're hungry, you throw a biscuit there. Until the day you die, you're hungry, the biscuit is still there, but it's cannot be eaten. I tell a story of how I made $1 million and I lost it. Okay. It's also because of a tip. This tip is not from a friend. This tip is from H magazine. You know H magazine every weekend they have this last two pages, right? Where this their technical analysis called Pula Wallet. Always come out eight charts, right? She took take up eight stocks and do her analysis on those eight charts. playing for school. This one, this point I entered here, and it was December 2004, where after the China Invasion of Switzerland, where the company went bankrupt because the CEO was dabbling in oil futures and lost $1 million. So at that time, everybody is afraid of Chinese company, and but I was quite bullish because I told myself, if this CEO just buy $1 million, I'm sure he will punish, he will go to jail, accountable for it. So, which other CEO there to do the same thing as me? So I went in here, I bought 600 possible warrants for 19 cents here. 600 warrants, that one is $180,000. Then I spoke, then I bought the one, I rolled over the warrant. That means as the warrant, as Costco rise, the warrant from 19 cents become 50 cents. I will sell the expensive Costco warrant 50 cents, and then I will buy back the newer, cheaper warrant. 19 cents, the newer warrant, with the further up expiry. So I keep rolling over, and in the process, 600 lots here, at 120K became, at this point, it was, $1.2 million and $2 million. I just roll over. Then at this point, my boss asked me for overseas treatment. So I went for overseas trip, USA, California, across US Taiwan, and then in a hotel, I think. So I bring my notebook along, I can carry on playing this game. But before I left, I saw the H magazine article behind Brother Warren said she sends a very bullish pattern here. The next target is here. So I said, wow, Brother Warren, H magazine, I care of him. Maybe before I go to Changi Airport, I went another 2 million warrants. This one, without money backing from my bank. I went double up my account. Then I went overseas. And then came down. And I was fixated on this target. And then on its way down, at first in US market, the problem is that I went to California, middle of the desert, not much internet. California time, Singapore time, market time is very out of whack. Become very groggy and don't know what I'm doing. And we came down, I averaged down. Average. Why? Because the more it comes down, the more I thought I'm going to make. Because of the margin up to the target. Because I fixated this target on my mind. So then my day here, I lose back all the money here. Where? Because I fixated somebody else's target in my mind. That's the problem. That's the problem of somebody give you a target price on a job. Better don't follow, better follow your own target. Target price that you derive using your own method. You know why? Because you derive your target price using your own method. When it doesn't work, at least you can, through your own method, switch this target price from here to here. You have this adaptability because you are the one who set that target price. You know your own vulnerability of your method and got this ability to switch this target price from here to here. But if this target price is given by then somebody else whom you don't even have the telephone number to call and who write who give target price like the way she used toilet paper every day, issue target price like nobody business and zero accountability. Then you don't have this flexibility to change the target price. So the more you fall, the more you want to buy the cost. So that's the problem. tipping. What's the whole purpose of tipping? Is to get somebody else entry price and somebody else cutting price, right? That's all right. So that's the nature of tipping. How I make $1 million and 1.2 and all. So I hope that you all get the message that
you will carry away the message that
tipping can destroy you.
So it's better to lose from your own target price than lose on somebody else's target price. Okay, thank you.